So now we're ready to talk about an algorithm for performing the computations that we illustrated with this concrete example that was just three equations and three unknowns. Here is our appended system. We've talked about how we can work first with the matrix and then do forward substitution with the right-hand side. So we're going to again talk about how to reduce the matrix to an upper triangular matrix. Now we're going to again use our slicing and dicing that we have seen several times before in the class to illustrate the computation that must be performed. So here we are with the thick lines at the edge. We move forward, exposing this diagonal element here and all of the elements below it. And now notice that in order to compute the entries in the Gauss transform, what we can do is think of this as a column vector, 4, 6, that has to be divided by the entry on the diagonal, divided by 2. And then we have to take the negative of it. And when we do that, we get the vector minus 2, minus 3. And lo and behold, those are exactly the entries that need to be filled in right here. Then when we apply this Gauss transform, we eliminate these entries right here, updating the other parts of the second and third row. And the other thing that we did here is say, look, since there are zeros sitting here, we can use those spots to store the multipliers. Now let's go back. Here we took the negative of the multipliers. We store the multipliers themselves. And if we go back two slides, this computation actually computes the multipliers, and then we negate those when we plug it into the Gauss transform. So that puts us right here. Then we move forward, we expose, and now we have to compute another Gauss transform. And again, we think of this as a vector. It just happens to only have one element in it, minus 16. We must divide that by the element on the diagonal, minus 10. That computes a vector of multipliers, which then, to plug into the Gauss transform, we have to take the negative of. When we apply that then, we get this. And again, what we do is the vector of multipliers we store over the coefficients that were just zeroed. In this particular case, it was only one coefficient. So now we have reduced the matrix to an upper triangular matrix, but we've also stored all the information we need in order to do our forward substitution. And notice that along the way, we were overwriting the original matrix. So then the forward substitution can proceed because we went and we stored the multipliers, and therefore we can apply the Gauss transform to the right-hand side, move forward, expose. Again, we stored our multiplier, therefore we can apply our Gauss transform again and move forward, and we're done. So now we have a mechanism for taking a matrix, transforming it into an upper triangular matrix, storing the multipliers so that we can recreate the history of the Gauss transforms that were applied, and then we can apply those Gauss transforms to a right-hand side subsequently. Now let's look at a typical step in this. Okay, at a typical moment in time, we have put zeros below the diagonal up to a certain point, so we're now working with this column. The fact that we overwritten those zeros with the multipliers is not pertinent to our discussion. What we want to do is compute all of these entries right here in a Gauss transform, so that when we apply the Gauss transform, we introduce zeros in these spots right here, leaving us with this matrix right here. And notice that the x's here simply represent typical entries in the matrix they don't have any specific value. This is a typical step. Anytime you identify a typical step, you're starting to converge on an algorithm. How can we go one step further? Here we have the typical state that we find ourselves in. Zeros have been introduced here. These parts of the matrix have already been finalized with the upper triangular matrix that we're after. These entries have been updated in some fashion along the way. In the current step, what we want to do is compute a vector of multipliers, of which we then take the negative, so that if we multiply this Gauss transform times this matrix, we end up with this right here. And the question now is how to compute these multipliers, this vector L2,1. You guys are getting really good at doing partitioned matrix-matrix multiplication. So if you look at this, this entry right here comes from doing the identity times this plus a zero matrix times that becomes this entry right here. In other words, it's left alone. Similarly, these entries come from the identity times that plus this times that, and the identity times that plus this times that. This quadrant right here is computed as this zero matrix times that plus this Gauss transform times this block right here. So if we now multiply this out, that's again a partition matrix-matrix multiplication. This entry comes from this times that plus zero times that. This entry here comes from one times that plus the zero row vector times that. This comes from this times that plus the identity times A21. And this right here comes from that times that plus the identity times A22. We would like to have zeros sitting right here. So what does that mean about how L should be chosen? So what do we want? We want this to be zero. So we want minus L21 times alpha 11 plus A21 to be the zero vector. That's up here. We know what alpha 11 is at this stage, and we know what A21 is at this stage, so we can rearrange this to solve for L21. And all you have to do is take the vector A21 and divide by alpha 11. Now remember, that's how we computed multipliers. If we go back here, we computed these multipliers, well, here we would have to take the negative of that, by taking these entries right here and dividing by the entry on the diagonal. Ah, so now we're starting to get somewhere. Now, once we then have computed L21, we notice that we want to take that result, multiply it times A21 transpose, and subtract the result off of A22. This is a rank one update. We've seen that before. Okay, it's an outer product that we subtract off of the matrix A22. Okay, so then here we have the algorithm. We compute the multipliers by dividing the entries below the diagonal by the entry on the diagonal. And once we've done that, we perform this computation right here. And what is that? That is the matrix A22, from which you subtract off a column vector times a row vector. The column vector sits right here. The row vector sits right there. Let's illustrate this with our matrix that we started our discussion with. We're right here. We need to take these values and divide it by that, and then we need to do this times that, an outer product, subtracting the result off of this matrix. When you do that, you get this. Then we move forward, we expose. Now we need to do this divided by that to compute our multipliers. And then we need to update A22, which is sitting right here. It just happens to only have one entry. by doing that times that. And we get this, and we have our upper triangular system. And we move forward, and we're done. This is an algorithm in a format that should be very, very familiar to you now. What about forward substitution? Well, if you have stored your multipliers, you can now apply that to a vector on the right-hand side to which you've already applied previous Gauss transforms. And the question then is, how do you compute the new one? Notice that this times that plus this times that plus this times that means that you don't change any of the values above the thick line. If you work out the details, what do you get? The first entry is just the first entry. 0 times that plus this times that plus this times that is just beta 1. And 0 times y0 minus L21 times beta 1, oops, that should be just beta 1, plus the identity times b2 means that your update of the rest of our vector is just this right here. And if you go back and you look very carefully at how you did the forward substitution, that's exactly the computation that you did. You took a multiple of part of the matrix, which now we call L, while before we called it A, and you added that, or you subtracted that from the rest of the entries. So the algorithm for forward substitution is then given right here. And we're marching through our matrix. Now notice that our matrix actually had the multipliers stored. So here we're not actually doing the computations with the matrix, but we're using the multipliers that had been stored. We can then use those to update the rest of our vector right there. We perform that computation, we move forward, and so forth. So here is the algorithm for performing forward substitution. And then the back substitution is exactly as it was before, and we'll look at an algorithm for doing that later in the week. Always check your answers, and let's summarize. What we now have is an algorithm for transforming a matrix into an upper triangular matrix. Okay. We have an algorithm for forward substitution. And if a new right-hand side came along at a later time, then we would not have to transform the matrix into an upper triangular matrix again, because we already have the Gauss transforms to use that need to be applied to the right-hand side.